Wanted to welcome you all this morning. I have a little video to play for you guys that, now 2 weeks ago we went off to youth camp, and this is a video just to kind of wrap up youth camp, so sit down, enjoy, and we'll play for you. We had 8-some students there and we had a great time. I enjoyed it. This is not my first time at Green Oaks. I went growing up, but this is the first time with you guys. And so it was a lot of fun for me. We had 6 people come to know Christ during the week, and so that was awesome. We had 5 students go with us, and so Logan and Bryson, Isabella, Ava, and Aiden. All went from our church. So if you see them, see how they enjoyed camp and everything like that. So a couple of announcements for you guys this morning. We have a few prayer requests. Got news this morning that Lois Crawford passed away. So we're praying for her family and just as those services go on. Also, her services will be on Wednesday. So if you want more information, call the office and they'll be able to get you more information on. We're praying for Roy McCable. His uncle is not doing well. And so we're praying for them and their family just as they're going through this time as well. And then Henry Kozlik, was that the other one? Okay. Pray for continued progress, that he continues getting well. So with the youth, we have the Royals and Cardinals game coming up here in a couple weeks. That is August 14th. So if you're interested in going to that game, be sure to let me know and get your tickets reserved so we can get enough tickets for the ball game. After church today, we're going to be having a party downstairs just to plan out different kinds of events that youth want to do during the school year further on. So if you want to be a part of that, stay after church. We'll be there till about 2:30 or so, and we'll get to hang out different things that you guys want to do and be a part of that. So with that, I don't think there are any more announcements. So if you will join me in prayer, and we will begin worship. Heavenly Father, we thank you for being able to be here today, that we are able to worship you and glorify you. God, you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are ruler over all creation. And God, we take comfort in knowing that you love us and that you are a good God. We pray that all people in the world will know your name. They will know how much that you love them, how much you care for them, God. You send your Son down to us. And I pray we will continue to praise your name in here and outside of these walls as well, that everyone would know the name of Jesus. Just something that I pray.
As we continue with our worship, let's stand and greet one another around you with a hearty handshake and a bright, cheery smile.
Thank you. beautiful special, and I am not afraid. 2 Corinthians 5:7 tells us to walk by faith and not by sight. I'm up here this morning, not to follow up with the choir, but I don't know how do you put it, you're unwelcome somebody? You're welcome to come here, but we have a couple people that are moving away, sad enough, that have served in this church for many, many years. And I'd like to get them up here if I could, Frank and Edith Bounce. Not sure of the exact year that they came, somewhere around the mid-80s, I believe. I do know Frank was involved in the Deacon's Visitation Ministry that for years he was involved in RAs, Sunday School Director. He's been on several committees, trustees, pastor search committee, and in the bus ministry. I could probably go on and on. There's, you know, anything that really needed to be done, Frank was always there, always willing to help. And this morning, I wanted to present him with a plaque. It has Frank Pounce, the First Baptist Family of Marshall, recognized you for 31 years of dedicated and faithful service to the Deacon Ministry, and with our heartfelt gratitude, presented this 25th day of July, 2021. With that, during this whole time, his wife Edith, she was certainly involved in a lot of things too. She's been in the nursery, she's a Sunday school teacher, worked for Vacation Bible School over the years, also served on committees, was heavily involved in the music, and I have here in 1988, she was with the children's youth choir. In 92, she started playing at the early worship service, and then in 2008, began being the pianist for the worship choir. And yeah, I know she's a familiar face. You see her up here playing the piano every Sunday. She has also been just a great blessing to this church, and we can't thank her and Frank both enough for the service and dedication that they have given to this church. Not just to this church, this body of believers, but ultimately they did it to serve God. And I think these ladies over here have something for Edith to present to her.
On behalf of the choir, we would like to present Edith with a shadow box with some of her favorite music titles in the shadow box. We also have a list of all of the members of the choir from the last several years. And we're going to miss her deeply, but we know that she'll find a special place at another church to use her talents for others. And we talked about this crying thing, but we're not doing very well.
I know, as Pam said, just because they're leaving this church and this group of people, I'm sure that God is not finished with them and their ministry. And I'd just like to go to the Lord in prayer right now and just pray for them and their new endeavors. Gracious Lord, we just thank you for the service that Frank and Edith have had in this group of believers in this church, Lord, to serve you. We thank you, Lord, for all the sacrifices and all that they have made, Lord, throughout the years to edify the body, Lord, just to lift you up. We thank you for that. Father, as they move on and seek new endeavors, we just pray that you would continue to bless them, Lord. We know that you're not through with their ministry. We just pray that you would bless them in finding a new church and whatever they have in store for them as they leave here and move to another chapter of their life. I pray that you would lead and guide them. Lord, please bless them as only you can. For it's through Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We're going to continue with our worship again, and we're going to sing a couple choruses. I sing praises and glorify thy name. Would you stand as we sing these two little choruses and prepare for all?
Lord, also ask you to be a part of the mighty spirit who brings us your message today. open up our ears and open up our hearts and change our lives, again, to follow your will. Lord, before our tithes and offering, I ask that you bless the gifts that we give back to you. You give us so much, giving back to you for your glory and your churches. Please ask a blessing on you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm really on. I know it's feeling good, but not that good. Thank you, Stephen and Michelle. God bless you, and thank you for sharing that song with us. To Frank and Edith, I just want to do this. They're my dear friends, and they have blessed my life, and they've blessed your life as well. They've been very faithful to serve the Lord with great integrity and great love for Jesus Christ. And thank you for that special offertory this morning. God bless you. Take your Bible this morning and be turning to the Old Testament book of Joshua, chapter 3. And in a moment, we're going to be looking at verse 5. And before we read verse 5, I just want to set the background of our passage this morning. The children of Israel have come right to the threshold of crossing over into Canaan. They're right there at the edge. In fact, the previous verses say they got there and they've camped for 3 days and 3 nights. And the officers have gone out into the midst of the camp to speak to the people. And they were about to cross over the River Jordan and possess their possessions, to move into the land of promise. God had for them a land that flowed with milk and honey. It was a land of great abundance, great plenty. And between them and this land of abundance, there lay a difficulty. It was a river. It's called the River Jordan. And the thing you need to know about this river is at this time of the year, it was not just a little bitty river. It was the rainy season. It was the time where the river had swollen and it covered a great territory of land. And it was seemingly impossible for them to get through the River Jordan. And so God performed a miracle and he got them in. He got them across into the land. You know, I think that's very, very critical. Many years ago, Baptist churches used to sing this song. Have you any rivers that seem to be uncrossable? Have you any mountains you cannot tunnel through? God specializes in things that seem to be impossible. And he knows 1,000 ways to make a way for you. The chorus goes, faith, mighty faith, the future sees and looks to God alone, laughs at impossibilities and cries out, it shall be done. Now, I believe that. And this morning we're going to be talking about the God behind the miracles, the God of miracles. And let's begin reading in Joshua chapter 3 and verse 5. It says, then Joshua said to the people, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you.
And Joshua spoke to the priest, saying, take up the Ark of the Covenant and cross over ahead of the people. So they took up the Ark of the Covenant and went ahead of the people. Now the Lord said to Joshua, this day I will begin to exalt you in the sight of all Israel, that they may know that just as I have been with Moses, I will be with you. You shall moreover command the priests who are carrying the Ark of the Covenant, saying, when you come to the edge of the waters of the Jordan, you shall stand still in the Jordan. Then Joshua said to the sons of Israel, come here and hear the words of the Lord your God. Joshua said, by this you shall know that the living God is among you. Let me tell you something right now. The living God is among you. He's here today. And then he says, and that he will assuredly dispossess from before you the Canaanite, the Hittite, the Hivite, the Perizzite, the Girgashite, the Amorite, and the Jebusite. Do you have any rivers that just seem to be uncrossable in your life? Do you have any mountains that you cannot tunnel through? God specializes in things that seem to be impossible. And he knows a thousand ways to make a way. For you, for me, for us, for our church. This morning I want to think about miracles and build this message on just two simple points. One is the possibility of miracles, and the other is the purpose of miracles. How many of you, by show of hands, believe in the possibility of miracles? Just put your hand up. Now, you may have your hand up, but there are a lot of people in churches across America, and even people within America who never go to church, and they have high questions about miracles at all. A lot of folks don't even believe in miracles. You may find yourself in the minority in this country. Miracles. What is a miracle? Write this down. A miracle is the Lord Jehovah doing wonders. It is Christ doing wonders. Now notice in this verse, he says in verse 5, consecrate yourselves. Another word for consecrate would be the word sanctify yourselves. And the word sanctify means to set yourself apart unto God. He's saying separate yourself for God. He says get ready, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders before you. I want to say, dear friend, that our God is a wonder-working God. Amen? He really is. Now, the secular humanist, and we have a lot of those in this country, the secular humanist, and humanism is just that man is central, man is everything, it's all about man. The secular humanist does not believe in miracles. And that's tragic. But the sad thing is that there are also many who occupy the pews of churches across America in the 21st century who also do not believe in the miraculous. They do not believe in miracles. Now, my thought is, if they do not believe in miracles, I wonder what kind of a God they have. What kind of God is that? You remember back in the day, I was much younger then, but there was going around America the phrase, God is dead. Remember that? It was in the magazines, God is dead. It was in the newspapers, God is dead. Aren't you thankful this morning that God is dead is dead? Yeah, really. And yet there's still a lot of people who don't believe in the Lord. They don't believe in heaven. They don't believe in miracles. Back in that time, I remember seeing a bumper sticker that was on the back of a pickup truck. And it caught my eye and it said this, my God is alive, too bad about yours. I like that. You know, God is alive. Our God is living, and He is a God of miracles. Now, none of you will have any problem getting past miracles if you can just get past the first verse in the Bible. Genesis 1:1 says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." In the beginning, God did what? He created. He created the heavens and the earth. And understand, if you can just get past that first verse, you're not going to have any problem whatsoever with miracles. Why? Because God created it all. He made it all. The God who made it all is not a prisoner of that which He made. You know, people say, well, you know, God, preacher, you know that God always operates according to the laws of nature. God is bound by the laws of nature. Listen, there are no laws of nature. There are only laws of God. They must go according to the laws of God. God made everything. Amen? And since God made everything, He can do with what He made as He pleases. I mean, can't Jehovah do that? Can't God be God? Well, of course He can. So first of all, we just have to admit the possibility of miracles because God is God. You say, well, Brother Mike, I just can't have faith in anything that I can't understand. And I don't understand miracles. Well, friend, listen, a lot of folks don't even understand how the windshield wipers work. Okay? They just press a button or they turn something on the column and the windshield wipers go left and right and left and right and left and right, but they're not sure how they go back and forth. Now, an engineer would know how that happens. And those who work on cars, they understand how that happens. But even an engineer doesn't understand some of the simpler things of life. You tell me how a black cow can eat green grass and give white milk that churns yellow butter. I mean, that's just hard to figure out. There are a lot of things we don't understand, but folks, I would not have any confidence in a God that I couldn't understand. God is beyond me. He just says there in verse 5, consecrate yourselves. For tomorrow the Lord will do wonders, miracles among you. So we believe in a miracle God. Amen? Amen. He's a God of might. He's a God of miracles. He is a God who is not a prisoner of His own laws and His own ways. Now sometimes we as Christians think God needs our help. We get a little bit embarrassed for God, so we try to make it easier for the Lord and more understandable. For example, there's the story in the Old Testament of Jonah and the fish. And you know, some people will try to move heaven and earth to find a fish that is big enough and large enough to swallow a man and to keep him alive for 3 days and 3 nights. Listen, you don't have to do that. That's not your job. If you found one, then it would just take away the miraculous out of it. The point is, God Almighty, Jehovah, prepared a fish. And in preparing that fish, if God wanted to, that fish could have had 3 rooms of furniture. He could have had a high-tech smart television. He could have had a refrigerator, an oven, a microwave oven. The point is, God prepared a fish, and that's the whole point. God, everybody come up real close. Maybe do this. Closer, come on. Whoa. God is in the miracle business. He is still alive. He is still well. God is doing miracles in our midst and in our lifetime. Now, we talk about the possibility of miracles. I believe that we all pretty much agree on that first point. Amen? So let's talk about the second one, the purpose of miracles. I want us to keep that in mind as God grows us as believers, as He helps us in our marriages, as He helps us with our children and our grandchildren, as He helps us to steer the right course as a church, as we look for God to do miracles in our lives. Let me tell you about the miracle that God did right here in Joshua chapter 3. Look at verse 5 again. He says, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow, He's telling the people, the Lord will do wonders among you. Now, let me tell you the miracle that God did for these people so long ago. The scripture says that there was an ark called the Ark of the Covenant. Got that? And the Ark of the Covenant, it was about the size of 4 foot by 2 foot by 2 foot. And the Bible says that it was a treasure chest of God's blessing, of His power, of His holiness, and that ark pictured the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, in order for them to get into the land of Canaan, the priests took the Ark of the Covenant on long poles, and they carried it on these staves, and they carried it right into the middle of the River Jordan. And as they stepped into the River Jordan, the water stopped flowing and just piled up in a great heap. And they set the ark down in the middle of the River Jordan, and the people walked through on dry ground. Amen? That was the miracle. It was an absolute miracle for the people of God. Now my question is, why did God do that? Why did God do that at that particular time? Why did God say to Joshua, and Joshua say to the people, tomorrow is going to be a day of miracles? I want to give you three basic reasons why God does miracles. Number one, God performs miracles when He wants to commence a program. Commence a program. When God is about to do something brand new, when God is about to do something different, so many times God confirms it with a miracle. Now back up to verses 2, 3, and 4. It says, at the end of 3 days, the officers went through the midst of the camp, and the officers commanded the people, saying, when you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God with the Levitical priests carrying it, then you shall set out from your place and do what? Go after it. However, there shall be between you and it a distance of about 2,000 cubits by measure. He says, do not come near it, that you may know the way by which you shall go. Now underscore this next part. He says, for you have not passed this way before. He's saying that you've never been here before. This is a new departure for you. And because it is a new departure, because you've not been this way before, God says, I'm going to commence it with a what? With a miracle. You know, God often does miracles to commence a program, just to let the people know that He is in it, that He is with them, that this is God's plan, that He has His stamp of blessing and approval upon it. You know, you're going to find when you read your Bible, when God does a new epic, when a new age comes along, when God commences a new program, often He puts His stamp of approval upon it with a miracle. And therefore, miracles come in what I call clusters in the Bible. They come in clusters. Miracles were not always consistent in the Word of God. There were times when there would be no miracles at all. And then there would be times where there would be a lot of miracles. An abundance of miracles. Now, you all of you have a bit of Bible history. And some of you probably have a lot of Bible history. For those of you who remember your Bible history, what happened around the creation? What happened there? Well, you just had a lot of miracles, didn't you? A lot of miracles took place there. All of creation was a miracle, and you have this cluster of miracles, and then after creation, things begin to dwindle down as far as miracles are concerned. And then you come to the time of the Exodus, that is, God's bringing the people out of the land of Egypt into the Promised Land, and once again you see this big cluster of miracles. And then after that, miracles seem to dwindle down again. And then miracles begin to take place with the ministry of Israel's prophets, with men like Elijah and Elisha. God gave a cluster of miracles. Miracles attended the ministry of Elisha and Elijah, and then they kind of dwindled down again. And then you have the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ in the New Testament times. And began the New Testament era, and the ministry of Jesus was confirmed with what? With miracles. Many miracles. Nicodemus said to Jesus, "No man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him." And then there was another cluster of miracles. And then in the ministry of the apostles and the apostolic church, there was a cluster of miracles. And what I'm saying is this. God says, "You have not passed this way before. I am starting something new. I am beginning something different. And therefore, I am going to put my stamp of my approval, my authority, my authenticity upon it with a miracle." I just believe God does that. Can I mention something? I think God did something like that for us as a church back in March of 2008. You say, what was the miracle? Well, Denise and I were in Florida. And I was pastoring a church there. And in 1 year, both her mom and her dad both broke their femurs. And they were in the hospital and rehab. And there we were in Florida, and we began to pray and say, "God, we think you're going to move us back to Florida. We're going to pray that you will let us go back and be with our parents during that final window of their lives." And we began to pray about that. My friend Alan Bartlett, who is now in heaven, I preached his funeral at First Baptist Breaktown. I sent him 5 resumes. He took 1 resume and got it to First Baptist Church of Marshall. Jim Ruff, of all people, got a hold of that. And there was a pulpit committee here. In fact, if you were on that pulpit committee, would you stand to your feet? If you were on the pulpit committee, I've got your names right here. Okay. All right. Now keep standing. You folks, you need to blame all these people who are standing. All right. Amen. That's right. And it was Jim Rock, Bill Barron, Frank Pouch, John Rains, Lois Turner, Francis Black, Kathy Rector, Debbie Kaiser. And I think Meredith, weren't you on there also? I thought so. Did I miss anybody? All right. And what happened is we began to talk to each other from Florida and Missouri. We had 3 or 4 or 5 conference calls. We came here 2 or 3 times. We were praying about it. You were praying about it. You as a church voted to call Denise and I to be your pastor. You said yes. We said yes. But listen, it wasn't my doing. It wasn't your doing. It was God Almighty's doing. And I call that a miracle that brought us from there to here. And I stayed with Bill and Shirley for a whole month. That's got to be a miracle. It was a blessing. Amen. He still does miracles in our midst. I had a clear, unmistakable, certain call to come, and we wed, and God blessed, and God has still been blessing to this very day. I call that a miracle. God performs miracles to commence a program. Secondly, God performs miracles just to comfort a people. Just to comfort a people. Now notice, God knew that these people in chapter 3, they were frightened. He knew that they were scared. And he says in verse 10 of chapter 3, Joshua said, "By this you shall know that the living God is with you. That he is with you. That he's among you." God said, "I'm going to do this miracle just so that you will know that there is a God and that I am with you." Listen, our God is not a dead God. Amen? He is a living God, and he is in our midst, and therefore you will know that the living God is among you. Now, God did not do miracles for these people constantly, but God did for them what he does for us, that every now and then, God just drops a miracle into our laps to remind us that he is alive and well, and that he lives in our hearts, he lives in our homes, and that every now and then he just drops a miracle. And these miracles, listen, they come sovereignly, and they come supernaturally, and they come suddenly, and you'll not be able to categorize them, you'll not be able to explain them, but God in his wisdom, God in his time, just drops a miracle every now and then to comfort his people. He is a miracle working God. Amen? You know, he has given sight to blinded eyes. I know of some. But he does not heal every person who is blind. I know for a fact that there are instances where God has just instantly removed cancer from a life. The cancer was there one moment and it was gone the next. But God doesn't drop a miracle for everybody that has cancer or some life-threatening disease. God worked a miracle in this scripture passage for the children of Israel to cross and get across the Jordan River. But from this time afterward, God did not stop up the Jordan again. And if people wanted to get across, they had to swim across, or they had to wade across, or they had to walk across, whatever they had to do, but God didn't do it for them all the time. But God does it enough to let us know that he is alive, and that he is with us, and that he is a God of might and miracle. So let's look at this. God, number one, God performs a miracle to commence something new, a new program, a new era. God performs miracles sometimes just to comfort our hearts and our homes and our lives. Number three, primarily, I want you to listen, God performs a miracle to communicate a principle. A principle. And this is where I really want us to bear down and focus for a moment. Go back to verse 10 and look at this. He says, "By this you will know that the living God is among you." Now, look at that next word, "and." You ought to circle that. If we just read our Bibles, we'll go right past this and miss this. This "and" is very key. He says, "and," notice this, "that he will assuredly dispossess from you the Canaanite, Hittite, Hivite, Perizzite, Girgashite, Amorite, Jebusite." Now, God is saying, listen up, I am going to do this. Not you, but I am. And God is communicating the principle that I am able. Now, every time they came to fight a Jebusite after this, a Jebusite or a Hittite or a Hivite or a Canaanite or a Perizzite or a Termite, whatever they were fighting, God did not perform a miracle again. I mean, it was warfare. They pulled out their swords. There was a lot of blood and sweat and tears, and yet still they were doing it in the power of Jehovah God. You see, there's a principle here. But dear friend, when you do anything in the name of God, in the name of Jehovah, the God who performed these miracles is the same God who is with you in your everyday work, in your everyday life, and your everyday walk. And you see, that's a wonderful thing, because there's a principle here that even though there may not be what we would call a classic miracle, like dividing the sea, drying it up, everything you do as a believer in Christ is, in a sense, a miracle. A miracle. Why? Because God is in you, and He is with you. And you cannot fail when you trust God, and therefore we are naturally supernatural and supernaturally natural in the very doing of everything from witnessing for Christ to leading someone to Christ to growing our marriages or our families or blessing our grandchildren to seeing God work in our church. Everything in that sense is a miracle because God is with us. We ought to recognize that. It's not always that God's going to turn water into wine every day. Okay? It's not always that God is going to stop up the rivers. But as the God of glory performed these other miracles, He is saying to you and to me, I am the God who is with you. I am the God who is with you, First Baptist Church. And I will be with you when you drive out the giants that are in your land, that are before you. There's a principle here. You remember in Acts, the Pentecost? Just nod your head if you remember that. All right, there was a principle at Pentecost. God performed a miracle at Pentecost. There was the mighty rushing wind. There were the cloven tongues of fire. Why? Well, God was commencing a new program. He was inaugurating a new age. But that does not mean, dear friend, that because today you don't see a cloven tongue of fire above me, or because today we don't hear a rushing wind through our auditorium, that doesn't mean that you and I are not to live in the power of Pentecost. Why? Because there's a principle here. A principle. Let me show you here from the Bible and make it a little bit clearer to you. Look with me in chapter 4 and verse 5. Joshua said to the people, cross again to the ark of the Lord your God into the middle of the Jordan. He's saying, I want you to take it back into the river and go there and back in the middle. And then he says, and each of you take up a stone on his shoulder according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Israel, and let this be a sign among you, so that when your children ask later, what do these stones mean to you, then you shall say to your children, because the waters of the Jordan were cut off before the ark of the covenant of the Lord when it crossed the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan were cut off, so these stones shall become a what? A memorial to the sons of Israel forever. What does that mean? Dear friend, God is saying that miracles are memorials. That you can look back on your past life and see where God has moved and worked. We look back and see what God has done. And I want to tell you that we have a greater miracle than the drying up of the Red Sea, and that is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We have a greater miracle than the drying up of the River Jordan, and that is the ascension and the enthronement of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, I want to ask, why then does God do a miracle? Well, He does it to commence a new program, something new, something different. He does it to comfort a people. He does it to communicate a principle. And listen, the very living out of our lives day by day are in themselves a spiritual miracle. And every day is to be lived in the power and dunamis, dynamite of God. And the same God that dried up the Jordan is the God that will be with you and with me in whatever we face in our lives. We are not alone. God is with us. And the same God that raised up Jesus Christ from the dead is the same God that's going to help us build and grow and thrive and be the people of God. And though we do it with our own hands, the doing of it will still be God who is in us. Because, dear friends, we are working from a miracle, and God is communicating a principle. Is it 11:05? It's time to quit. How many of you believe in miracles? Amen. Remember, a miracle is the Lord doing wonders. How many of you have ever experienced a miracle in your life? Would you just hold your hand up? Amen. How many believe our church has experienced miracles in our history? Absolutely. You say, Brother Mike, I sure would like to have a miracle. I need a miracle in my life. Let me tell you something. If you're a Christian, you've already had a miracle. The greatest miracle in the world is called the new birth. The new birth. It is a greater miracle because of its cost. You know, when God stopped the River Jordan, it didn't cost God anything to do that. But when God stopped the water of judgment at the cross, it cost God His own dear Son, Jesus Christ, with blood and agony. Your being saved was a greater miracle. A greater miracle because of its cost and because of its consequences. You say, I want a miracle. Friend, you've got one. There's no greater miracle than the new birth. And oh, my dear friend, if you only understood that you are a miracle. You have any rivers that seem to be uncrossable? I kind of think I do. You got any mountains you cannot tunnel through? God specializes in things that seem to be impossible. And He knows a thousand ways to make a way through you. And all God's people said,
amen.
Let's stand together. We're going to begin to sing our hymn of invitation this morning. And I want to give a twofold invitation. And the first part of this invitation is very, very simple. If you have a need in your life, if you say, God, I need a miracle. I'm going to ask you to do something that's a little bit out of your comfort zone. If you really need a miracle, then you need to show God that you mean business. So we're just going to bow our heads, let the piano play. And if you really need a miracle, I'm going to ask you to slip out of the pew, come to the altar, kneel before God, and say, God, I need a miracle in my life, and here it is. And just tell Him. And then once you've done that, then get back up and go back to your seat. So as Edith plays the piano, this is your time to come and just talk to God. Well, I know you can do it from the pew, but that doesn't require any effort. If you really need a miracle, slip out from where you are and just come and kneel before God. Say, God, this mountain is too big for me. I need your hand, your touch. I need a miracle in my life. Just come and tell God that. And once you've told God that, then just slip back to your pew. We'll just take a moment for you to come and do that. Just express to God. Let Him see how serious you are. has a miracle to comfort a people. He wants to comfort your heart and your life. To commence a program to communicate a principle that He is with you. God sees your obedience this morning. We're going to begin to sing this hymn of invitation. The altar is open, the second part of this invitation, for you to come and embrace Jesus Christ. To say, I need Jesus as my Savior and my Lord. I know that I'm not a Christian. I know I've never really bent my knee to Christ. But I need Jesus in my life. I'm coming to rededicate my life to Him. I'm coming to move my membership today to First Baptist Church. I want to grow and thrive in this church. Whatever your decision, you come as we sing. Let's go to the Lord in a closing word of prayer. Frank, you and Edith, where are you guys headed to? Republic, Missouri. That's a good town. And it is a miracle. Bang, 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 bang. Sold your house. You bought a house. You bought a house before you sold your house. That's a miracle. You know, miracles come in all shapes and sizes. And there in the public, just know that we love you and you'll always be a part of our hearts and lives. We pray that God will do a miracle and find the right church for you guys. I'm sure He's already got that in the mix. Brother Frank, would you go to the pulpit, please, and lead us in our closing word of prayer? Love you, my friend. God bless you. Let's pray together.
Our Father, Lord, for this opportunity to come here today to hear your words, Brother Mike. Thank you, Lord, for the message. Thank you, Lord, for this church. And what it means to my wife and I over these years. This has been my church since I was a child. And it's hard to leave family. Lord, we know that you have something else for us. Somewhere else where we can do some good for you, Lord. So just ask that as we leave, that you guide and direct us. And you continue to bless this church and whatever needs to be done here. You will provide as you always have. We thank you, Lord, for your love. Thank you for Jesus, our Savior. And thank you, Lord, for this church family, for all who have touched our lives in the years past. In Jesus' name we pray.